So, good evening one and all, and welcome to the 44th online APEX-CCB's book review meet. So here today we have very interesting books that are to be reviewed. First in line we have Professor Ravi Garu, Professor K.Ravi Garu, and he'd be reviewing Billions and Billions, Thoughts on Life and Death at the Brink of the Millennium by Carl Sagan. Without further ado, I think I'll give it to Ravi Garu. Ravi Garu.
Good evening to all the CCBians, and thanks, Radhika. This is the book,
yes.
Billions and Billions, Carl Sagan. This is his last book. These are a collection of essays which he had written earlier. And of course, it does have some sort of an epilogue, and which is actually written by him and when he was in the hospital. It's also subtitled as Thoughts on Life and Death at the Brink of the Millennium. Whatever that is, the book is divided into three parts, and they have been named differently. These are collection of essays. The first part is named as The Power and Beauty of Quantification, and part two is What Are Conservatives Conserving, and the third part is Where Hearts and Minds Collide. The canvas is very vast, very big. It covers an entire spectrum of things, from stars to the fetus, from life to death, from creativity to destructive wars, and several other things in between. So the title seems to come from his first essay, Billions and Billions. But then you see this aspect of numbers being repeated in one or two other of his essays also, which are very, very, very interesting. The first one essentially talks of billions of galaxies and stars and the cosmos. And there was a talk host for his talk shows, Carson, who was his friend. And he used to start the show uttering the word billions and billions. So that's how it became popular. But then, it was not what exactly Carl Sagan himself used in the talk show, though he did discuss about billions and billions. So here, in the first essay, he mentions about how Earth had started billions of years ago. The millions of billions of people are populating the Earth, and different countries, US in particular, etc. And the billionaires that exist, the wars that have left millions dead and millions injured, and then the possibilities of nuclear war and the millions that can die if there is a nuclear war between USA and Soviet Union. And he also talks of the age of the sun and the possible burning up. So we find this topical. I think a few days back, maybe 2-3 days back, somebody was talking about when the sun will die. So it was in news in the newspapers. But then he says whether it is 5 billions or 5 millions, it has little bearing on our personal lives. But then to know that the ultimate fate of Earth that way gives us a picture of the future. In the sense, we have enough time to make our lives pleasant and make the lives of the future generations happy and present. But then there is this danger of ending of the civilization by man himself on his own without any external sun burning up earth, etc., etc. So the question is whether we'll keep this earth safe enough for the future generations and for time immemorial. Because these are the things that he discusses in this beautiful book. And of course, he also talks of mathematics and physics and exponentials, how they have a bearing on our understanding of so many things that exist today, both in science and in life. So talking of numbers, he says, scientists have calculated those numbers in millions and trillions and made it easier by adding a square root, etc., etc. And he also mentions about the Mayan calendar and how the Indians calculated the life of the present incarnation of the universe as 8.6 into 10 to the power of 9 years old. And he says it's almost right on the button. And he talks of exponentials by referring to the famous Russian chessboard, where the number of moves can be infinite. And we also have the story of an intelligent Brahmin going to a king and asking for rice using those exponential calculation. So, and then he talks about humans as hunters and gatherers and how their life started with teamwork. The entire emphasis again slowly moves from an individual to teamwork. How as a civilization and as earthlings, we have to cooperate in order to survive. This becomes poignant in the context of climate change and the disasters that can follow from climate change. And also the existing nation state system, which somehow gets embroiled in wars on the basis of national identities, which did not exist, for example, thousands of years ago, before nation state was ever born. Man was a family, perhaps a tribe, and then a small group, which moved and became a small kingdom, and later on became the nation state. And now the nation states is an identity we all acquire by birth, whether we like it or not. And then once we have that, we become very patriotic about it and we are ready to go for war on the basis of this identity, which again is a created identity, because the nation state actually emerged only about 1500 years ago or about 2000 years ago. That's the maximum in the modern form. So what was life before that, thousands of years ago? He discusses those issues. And then he also talks of man trying to calculate the future and how you can look at the world from different perspectives in terms of light, the light spectrum, or in terms of sound waves, etc. So you understand the world through our senses, particularly sound and light. These are aspects that he discusses in the essay, The Gaze of God and the Dripping Faucet, where he mentions all these things very beautifully. And then he says, the wave particle dualism is another reminder of a central humbling fact. Nature does not always conform to our predispositions and preferences to what we deem comfortable and easy to understand. So it has its own dynamics. We are trying to understand those dynamics, but we can't direct those dynamics. I mean, we can't control them. Because in a limited way, we can. But then there are things that are beyond human control. And then he also mentions here that we are prejudiced toward visible light. There are things that are unseen by us. And there is an entire world there, which perhaps the composite eye of a bee can see, or some birds can hear. So, and then he talks about, in this, he also talks about the color and its importance, and how even the skin color makes us judge people and come to conclusions, etc. And then he talks of four cosmic questions, which he felt are important or at least interesting. One is, was there ever life on Mars? And then, is Titan a laboratory for the origin of life? That's the big moon of Saturn. And then, is there intelligent life elsewhere? And lastly, what is the origin and fate of the universe? So these are really big questions. And then he discusses some of these, not in great detail, but definitely profoundly. And then he says, The startling revolutions in all four of these areas can be expected in the next decade or two. And the most amazing discoveries will be ones we are not today wise enough to foresee. So he hopes there will be several things that are coming up in terms of understanding of life, the cosmos, and our own earth, where we live. And then he talks of the several planets that exist, and astrometry. And he also talks of the internet. And then focuses substantially on environment and climate change. He says that human advancement and technology and abuse of nature has led to our present predicament, where climate change is going to be quite dangerous for the survival of civilization and humanity. And unless we control several of our technological negatives, the outcomes of our modern technology, like, say, for example, CFCs and several others like those, we are in for really troubling times. And he says that it's important that we preserve the environment and the future for the future generations. And then he interestingly goes into mythology and talks of Croesus and Cassandra, the stories about predictions in Greek mythology, of the Delphic oracle, and then the king of Lydia, Croesus. So he had the capability to predict, so did the Delphic oracle. And Cassandra, a princess who could predict things, but nobody believed her because she was always talking about negatives, and that resulted in disasters. And then he says, it's important for policymakers to take scientists and technologists seriously, because with the information that we have and the data and the knowledge we have, it is possible now to predict better, if not exactly and 100% accurately, definitely much, much better than what was. And policymakers will be at fault not to take into consideration these predictions. And any sensible policymaker would do that. In fact, here there are some interesting things that we can take from life. Brazil saw a quantum leap in its scientific research 10 years back, before the new dictator came into existence, where all their ministers for science and technology were scientists. And today in developed world, nearly 80% of all the finance ministers are economists. That's quite sensible, taking into consideration the complexity of the economic situation that exists in the world. But if you don't do that, and you consider that you know everything, then policies are bound to be failures or stupid. And we are seeing that in several places, including India. And then he talks of the ozone hole and how it came to being because of man's stupidity. And he, for example, says DuPont at one point sold CFCs to the tune of $600 million a year. And it also tried to defend CFCs, saying that they were safe and good because it needed another 10 years to withdraw CFC production. And so it gave ads and supported the CFCs for a long time before every scientific paper 100% clearly demonstrated through experiment that they are bad and dangerous. So it is possible that corporates and corporations and businesses can fund fake science and fake scientists who are insincere to give us fake knowledge and fake information to obfuscate reality and, of course, benefit the industry. These things are also discussed here. And he calls this ambush, the warming of the world. And he also discusses escape from ambush, that is how we can save this world. Crossing my time, I think I still have a few minutes more.
Yes.
And then there is a beautiful piece on religion and science. And he says, they were both clashing for a long time and still do many a time. But then he says, if the potential of scientific belief and the following it has can also be channelized to push science and technology and reason and knowledge that comes with it, if there is an alliance, at least on some things, the results can be much, much better. And here he gives the example of some of the Christian churches and others coming together to support climate and environmental protection laws and agreements. He says if that's the type of realization that comes, and they can put belief systems aside for the benefit of mankind, it would be much better. So such an alliance perhaps would be beneficial. And he discusses these things elaborately and very interestingly, and it's worth reading. And then he talks about the common enemy. Here I think I get carried away. and then the rules of the game. He says there are several rules of the game. He talks of game theory and human beings standing up for ethics and goodness. And if you stand for goodness and ethics and you lose, what should you do? What options do you have? Do you go in for a silver rule or a brazen rule or an iron rule, where authority and power can do whatever it likes, and that's how the world should be ordered, and that's good enough? So, I mean, these are the rules of the game, the human game that's being played by man. He talks of those things. And there, he talks of wars, about Gettysburg. One cannon killed a few people in a bush when one cannon fell on a certain bushes there in the war, Gettysburg War. One horse and two people died. Later on, when the power of this became more substantial, it led to an entire block being wiped out during the First World War and Second World War, in the beginning, particularly in the First World War. That's how the word blockbuster came into being. And then later on, bigger weapons, bigger and bombs, which can kill thousands. And then, of course, the ultimate weapon, nuclear weapon, which wiped out two cities in Japan. And now there was a point of overkill when both US and Soviet Union had 60,000 nuclear weapons in megatonnage, not thousands of tons. So the bomb that was thrown on Hiroshima is a 20 kiloton bomb, 20,000 tons of TNT, equivalent to that. And it killed about 4 lakh people. And imagine the smallest thermonuclear weapon. It is 1 megaton, 1,000 times more powerful than what was thrown on Hiroshima. And you have multi-megaton nuclear weapons today. You can wipe out the civilization itself, definitely wipe out Soviet Union and USA. Both can do that to each other. So he interestingly says, all the lives of all people in USA are in the hands of Soviet Union. And if they want it, they can wipe it out in 20 minutes. The same goes true for Soviet Union. All their lives are now in the hands of USA, and they can wipe it out in 20 minutes. He says, the entire program started to protect their own land. The entire program, the nuclear weapons or the entire war machinery, was built to save and protect and defend. But that goal itself is lost one because of this situation. And more number of countries are now with these weapons. So that's a really big problem.
Last 1 minute. If 1 or 2
okay,
minutes.
Okay.
And we'll have questions.
Yes, I think just 2 minutes. Two minutes in and day.
Sure.
Carl Sagan had a rare disease, and he had bone cancer. And he was admitted to hospital and came out of it several times. His own sister was the donor for his bone marrow. And he was just gloating about whether he would acquire her habits and things like that. And then he was able to look at the world differently, he says. And he saw how much goodness there was around. He was also saying that death itself is a learning. He says it makes you aware of the beauty and the grandness of life, of the cosmos, of everything. This is what he talks of towards the end, even in the epilogue, even when he was in the hospital. He was saying that death itself is a beautiful experience, in the sense, he says, everybody has to go through it, and that also is a beautiful experience. If there is afterlife, perhaps he wanted many things to be done in his life. He couldn't do. Maybe I can do that. But then he doesn't believe in afterlife. He says, even then, whatever has been provided, the minutes and the time that he existed on earth is beautiful and worth it every moment. So this in short is, I don't think I did justice in the sense, it's a very beautiful book covering several aspects of life and the cosmos. And I think everybody, if they have an opportunity, should read it, at least read some of these essays once in their lifetime. I would recommend it as read this book or read some essays from this book before you die. Thank you.
Thank you.